difficult or really easy?
It's a mix of the two. You have to take notes, and it's a lot of settings.
I'm taking notes right there.
All right, so I'm going to set up my preferences just because I like to have them set up the way I like them. I can set this to 30 frames per second. Actually, this is all irrelevant. You don't need to worry about it. I did that for me. All right, so basically, just make a sphere here.
No, I like curve.
Bless you. let me just make this
space bar.
Space bars for babies. All right, so here's my sphere. Yeah,
awesome.
So,
how'd you make that?
You're gonna go to your rendering tab.
Wait, stop.
Right? Slow down, Speedy. Yeah. All right, so you go to your rendering tab, and you'll see this little fur menu over here. Right? Basically, what we want to do is we want to make this ball furry, right? Okay. Yeah. So when you hand in your furry balls next week, make sure that they look
my
nice.
Balls are gonna be the furriest.
Alright, so this is what you start with, right? So imagine this is a character, right, from your movie. The first thing you want to do when you're gonna do fur on something is check the UVs, right? So I'm just gonna open up my UV texture editor here. That is the default UVs for a sphere. Those are totally fine. Now the reason I say you gotta check those is because your fur direction, your fur growth is going to be based on your UVs. So that's fine right there, but if we had a character that, like, you know, you had a body, imagine your character is like this, right? This is like his body, right? The fur is all going to grow based on the UV direction, right? So if we had this character cut up in pieces, and we had half of them going that way,
different
and half of them go in this way. Right? What's going to happen when we put the fur on this is half of the fur is going to grow this way, and the other half is going to grow this way. So when you see the character, there's going to be a big seam down the center, and you're going to get fur that does this, which looks stupid.
Unless he's like a stuffed animal or something, which in which case it would be, and you wouldn't want to maybe have good directions, but
you'd
the seam would look
right. You could still do a seam, but then you do your UVs a little differently. For a stuffed animal, they probably part. You'd have something go this way, something this way, but you wouldn't have that extreme, like,
yeah.
So a lot of times student work, you'll see characters that have fur, their fur is all jacked up. That's probably why, because the UVs aren't laid out well. So there's a whole bunch of reasons you want to have nicely laid out UVs. It's super important for fur, yeah.
Does it matter how many divisions, subdivisions?
No.
What if you want to do, like, an extreme part in their hair?
You could do that. I'll show you how to do that. You could do it with the UVs, or you could do it with texturing and stuff. But for now, I've just got a sphere with UVs that are already laid out, so I'm going to go fur, attach fur description, new. There you go, it's that easy. Now the sphere is furry. And we're done. No, we're not done. Let me show you what this looks like. That's what it looks like. Looks awesome, huh?
That's awesome.
So basically, the way fur works is you have control over the base of the fur, which is the piece of hair, right? So there's hair and there's fur. They're two different things. Hair is a dynamic system. Fur is just the, like, think of an animal's fur, like pelt, that kind of thing. Why you would use one over the other would be if your fur doesn't need to move, like you're doing very short fur, like a squirrel or a beaver or something like that. Or if you're doing a hairstyle that's not going to move, or you're doing grass, or anything like that. Your hair, you have control, like I said, over the base and the tip. So this is the surface that you're growing it from. Alright, so that's the base, this is where you're growing it from. This is one hair, right? You got control over the base and the tip. right? So what you do with the hair from the base of the tip is going to determine what kind of hair you've got, what kind of fur you've got, the look of it, right? So let's try to do like a soft kind of brown fur, or like an animal's fur kind of.
I like something.
All right. So what we're going to do is I'm going to edit my fur description, right? So I'm going to go here, fur description one. I'm going to call this animal fur. I'm going to call this base, or animal fur, base. This is going to be the standard one. So we're going to do three, right? So this is the one I'm going to use first. So I'm not going to worry about density or global scale yet. These settings are going to change the scale of the fur, like how long is it, right? Density is how many hairs or how many pieces of fur on this sphere, right? So these don't necessarily represent actual pieces of hair. It's just a visual guide, so you know roughly how long they are, right? So you have control over all these things over here. Let me move this up a little bit.
Did you type in normal? What was the name of it?
I just called it animal fur base. So here you've got base color, right? These are all set in white right now. Base color, tip color. You've got base ambient color, tip ambient color. That works just like a shader with ambient colors. Specular color, that's the color of the specular light on it. So when it catches a highlight, that's the color the highlight's going to be. Length is how long the hair is. Baldness is it's going to give it gaps between hair. So if you want sparsely dense or sparsely populated fur, if you're doing something that's got mange or something that's going bald, something like that. Inclination, roll, what would those determine how that fur is oriented off the surface? Base opacity and tip opacity, that's how opaque the fur is. Like I said, everything goes from base to tip. So usually what I do for soft fur, that's what we're going to want to do for this, is I put the base at no opacity, or at one for the opacity, so it's totally opaque, and at tip I go zero. So it gives you a nice softness.
So let's just look at some of these values right now. First, I'm going to change the base color. I'm going to make it like a brown color. Actually, let me make a shader also for my sphere. That's the when I do hair and fur, I usually make the surface the same color as the base of the hair, so that if I do see through it at all, I don't see any like bright colors or anything. So my base color, I'm just going to eyedropper that color that I picked for that. And then my tip color, I'm going to go lighter than the base. So I'll eyedropper that, and then a little bit lighter than that. So let's see what that looks like. Alright, so that's where we're at now. So we went from this to this. Right? All we did was change the color. So what I'm also going to do is I'm going to change the base width so that it's a little bit wider than that 0.05. I'm going to go 0.075. So now you can see they're a little more triangular than they were before. The other thing I'm going to do is I'm going to increase my density to 5,000. So now you see my feedback in my Maya window didn't really change at all. See that? Even though I'm changing this, this looks exactly the same. This affects the rendered hairs. So now when I render this, you'll see there's a lot more hairs there. See that? So it makes a big difference. Like I said, this is just a visual guide to give you an idea of where they are. They're like guide hairs. Each one of these represents a couple hundred hairs that you're going to render. So now the other thing I'm going to do is I'm going to change the opacity for the tip. So right now it's at 1, I'm going to change it to 0. Watch how soft this gets. See that?
Ooh.
Nice. So that's just the difference between the opacity on the tip.
Tip opacity.
Yeah. Now the other thing I'm going to do is I'm going to start to, I want my fur to kind of hug the surface of that a little more instead of just sticking out like a pin cushion. So I'm going to grab this inclination and rotate that. Actually, I'm going to rotate my sphere.
Hold on a minute. What are you going to best? What did you do?
inclination. That's what I adjusted. And I also rotated my sphere around 180 degrees because I didn't like the way that that was going. I could have also rotated the UVs on my object, and I'll do that instead. So it'll show you exactly what the... So if I select the UVs, right, and I rotate them, see what happens to the hair there? So the hair position is based on the UV. So because I'm rotating the UVs, the hair is rotating. Or the orientation of it's rotating.
You said 180?
Yeah, I just flipped it. So that's what we've got now. I want to make this a little more furry, so I'm going to increase the density again. But your render times are going to start to go up quite a bit.
As is right there, but how long does it take you for render?
That took 1 second.
Okay.
But it's not moving. I have just the default light in the scene, all that kind of thing. So here's where I'm at right now. So that went pretty quick. I got from that to this pretty quickly. But we're not done, because that still looks really fake.
So what did you change? You're starting to just bump up the density?
Yeah, I bumped up the density, I gave it a little bit of inclination, I changed the color. I don't know what you have your settings set to. It's possible you have... If it's looking like metal, you might have way too many hairs. I'm going to change this to mental ray. And you'll see that the look of it gets much better, but the render time goes up quite a bit. So that's a big difference from the Maya. I want you to render it so it looks good. If it looks better in Mental Ray or it looks better in Maya software, it's up to you.
Yeah.
So I'm going to adjust my spec a little bit to make it a little bit darker. All right, so... here is we've got base curl and tip curl, right? They do what they sound like they do. They curl the base, but they curl the tip. I usually try to curl the tip a little bit to give the fur a little bit of shape. But you notice now my fur is really dense and it's all the exact same length and the exact same curl, so I'm getting this like perfect edge. You don't want to do that on your fur, unless you're doing, excuse me, like a seal or something like that that's got fur that's really densely packed. And you see this renders with an alpha as well, so you can comp this on something later. Now the other thing we've got here is we've also got this thing called Scraggle. Makes it look real nasty. Everybody laughs when we cover Scraggle. So this is what Scraggle does. So if you're trying to make a tennis ball, you could use Scraggle. Now, the other thing too is that down here you've got segments. Right? By default, it's set to 10. Segments is how many divisions is along each piece of hair, right? So at 10, that's what Scraggle looks like. If I change the segments to 2, and I render this, if I render this here, there's fewer segments, so it's going to render a little faster, but I'm not going to get the fidelity that I had before, because it's only got 2 chunks to work with.
So segments is for what?
Segments is how many pieces are, how many times the hair itself is divided along the side. So I'm going to move that back to 10. I'm going to change my Scraggle back to 0 here. I'm going to show you this other stuff too, and we'll use this later, but there's also something called clumping, which clumps the hairs together. Alright, so we'll use this when we do the wet fur. So there's clumped together fur.
It's like anime hair.
Yeah, you're trying to do Cloud from Final Fantasy process. All you need is a huge sword. clumping frequency, that's how much it clumps. Clump shape determines where it clumps. Is it clump at the tip of the hair? Is it clump at the base? Is it clump in the middle? Segments is 10. Attraction, that has to do with how the hair is attracted to itself. The other thing we're going to do is, let me get this back to a spot where I'm decent. I'm actually going to let this, I'm going to take some of the inclination off of this so it doesn't quite hug the surface as much. Okay, so with this render here, you'll see I have one color set up for the base, one color set up for the tip. The length is all exactly the same because you set the length up, right? The inclination is all exactly the same. In nature and in life, nothing is uniform like that. So nothing, I mean, this would be good for a toy or something that's manufactured, but not for a character, because you're going to want to have some, I mean, unless the character's manufactured, if you're like a stuffed animal toy, then maybe. But for the most part, things are not uniform. Even if you go and you get a haircut, no matter how good your haircut is, you're going to have little bits that are slightly longer than the other, where they hang, they lay a little differently on your head. You know, if you wake up in the morning, your hair's all kind of crazy, that kind of thing. That's what we want to get into this right here. So how do we do that? Well, we go down to this tab down here called Details. If we open it up, you see that for every attribute up here, there's a lot of things to touch. Down here, each one of those has a details thing. So if I go into the length, got this map offset, map multiplier, noise amplitude, noise frequency. What that does is it adds noise to that value. So if I add noise to the length, it's going to make the hair have different lengths. So let me put just a little bit on here. Change it to 0.5. Let's render this region. So you see how I don't have that uniform circle anymore. I've got slightly more and less length. So I can crank this amplitude up higher if I want to kind of increase the effect. So if you're doing like Kodiak Bear or something, you probably want to have quite a bit of length variation there. So you get a little bit longer bits and shorter bits. Now the other thing is that all of this stuff can also be driven with texture masks. So you can paint a grayscale image with black being 0 and white being 1, just like a bump map, and that would affect things like length, inclination, baldness, all that stuff. So you could bring in a character and paint out where you don't want any fur. So let me show you that right now too. So actually you can do it for the color too. But it only affects that base. So if I change this to a checkerboard pattern, and I change this to a checkerboard pattern, this is what that's going to look like. Bandersnatch. I mean, I still have the brown base on the shader on the sphere, but you can see in the fur what that did.
So if you wanted to make like cheetah spots or something like that.
Yep, exactly. So the other thing I can do, let me undo that. Now for my length, I can create a new texture, and now that drives the length of the fur. It's hard to see because it kind of winds up with the camera there. This is really short fur here, and then it's longer here because there's white.
Is there a way to increase that effect like you would with like a bump map when you apply it to like the length?
You mean like go past the value of 1 or or something?
Well, was that at its maximum, like its extreme example?
Yeah, because it's black and white.
Well, say, like, for example, the bump value, right? You can set it to 1, or, like, you, what is the default?
It goes
it higher.
It goes from 0 to 1. You can't go higher than 1.
Okay.
Alright, so we're back to where we were. Right? So now the other thing I want to do is I want to. Actually, let me just make sure this is. Excuse me. Right.
So are all those settings from a 0 to 1 value?
Pretty much. Yeah.
Okay.
So I've got a little bit of noise in my length value, which gives me the nice, more natural look. But now I want to do something similar with the colors. I don't want a uniform color. I want to have a little bit of variation in the color. Yeah, like a Wookiee. So I can go to base color, base color, and I can give it a little bit of noise. So I'm going to say 0.5, and then tip color, I'm going to say 0.5. You can also load maps in here too. Add item or remove item. That's where you put a lot of texture stuff as well. So now with these renders, I'll have quite a bit of color variation in here. I went a little higher than I normally would just so you can see the difference, the contrast in it. See the difference in color there a little bit. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to crank this density up a little bit more to 15,000. I'm going to save this so in case it crashes on me. So this is the kind of thing you would do if you're working on a film or a project where you needed to show what the character is going to look like with fur. This is like our standard. This is what the character looks like 98% of the time, right? So this is like our standard. And then to the left and the right, we're going to make the dry fur version and the wet fur version. So there's our sphere with the fur on it, right? So what I'm going to do is I want to make the two other versions. I'm just going to duplicate this and move it over here, then duplicate this and move it over here. Now, I don't want to have to remake this from scratch, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to duplicate this fur description and then edit it and apply it to the other ones. So I'm going to call this one normal sphere. This one will be the wet sphere, right? Yeah. And this one's going to be the dry sphere. The other thing I'm going to do is I'm going to duplicate my shader here. Actually, let me call this one normal. This one's going to be for the wet sphere. I'm going to make this color darker. So that'll just help me visually, even without the fur, to know which one's which. Alright, so what do we do to this to make wet fur look wet and dry fur look dry? Let's look at some examples. Base here, right? It's also very shiny because you still have water in there, right? So your hair is just fibers, right? And the water gets in there. So, I mean, everybody's washed their hair before, right?
We're supposed to wash it?
Yeah. So you'll notice, like, when your hair is wet, it looks darker. It's a darker color. If you ever went swimming or whatever, your hair is a darker color. And it kind of sticks together, right? So you got bits here at the end that kind of clump. Let's see if I can find that. Notice the tail hair is not wet yet, right? So it's all nice and fluffy. But you look at the water on his underbelly here, and it's all, or the hair on his underbelly, and it's all darker shade, right? The fur is darker shaded, and it's real shiny because it's wet. It kind of clumps together. And he hates that water. He's going to bite it. I'm gonna go under fur here, and I'm gonna say fur descriptions more. I'm gonna go to duplicate animal fur base. Right? So now when I go to my edit fur description, I have two. I've got this fur base, I've got this fur base one, right?
So fur description more, duplicate animal fur base.
Yes. So I'm gonna rename that one. So instead of animal fur base, I'm gonna call it animal fur wet. Right? Then I'm gonna select the wet sphere. I'm going to say fur, attach fur description, animal fur wet. And now that one's got hair on it as well, for fur.
Where did that again?
I called it animal fur wet. So within animal fur wet, I want to adjust a couple things right now to make sure that it looks wet. So I'm going to bring my colors way down so they're darker, quite a bit darker. And I'm going to take my spec color and I'm going to crank that way up. The other thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take out the tip curl, or change it to 0.5 actually, because that's the middle. I'm going to also take my tip opacity and change that back to 1. So let me zoom in on these so you can see the difference already, just from changing a couple settings.
You did tip opacity, what would it do?
Tip opacity, I took out the tip curl, and what else? I changed color. So you can see this takes a little bit to render. Don't wait until last minute to render this out. You just have to hand it a still, you don't have to hand it animation.
So when you change it to production value,
yeah.
Is it a substantial difference, or is it just like when we do other things in
It's pretty similar. Okay. The thing is, what MentalRay is doing is it's taking each hair and it's converting it to a hair primitive.
Yeah.
This is actually making geometry kind of out of it for the render, so that takes time. The more hairs you have, the longer it takes. But you don't want to
don't want to skimp on either.
Yeah.
Otherwise, your character looks like something wrong with
it. Yeah, so it's not going to just make less hair or something like that, right?
Well, there's a couple ways around it. You could do less segments on the hair. So if your hair's not that long, you'd get away with much less segments. But for something this length, you want to have at least 10 segments on it. You could go a little lower, maybe 8 or 5, but you're going to start to see chunkiness if you get too close to it.
So what did you change on it?
To make it look wet. I changed the highlight, which totally blew it out, it looks like. So I'm going to bring that spec color back down some more. Actually, I'm going to change the sharpness of the spec. If it's at 50, I'm going to bring this to like 10. See what that looks like. Because you want like a real sharp highlight. What's the wrong way? You have to now select your sphere and attach the first description to it. I keep thinking the camera is somebody's hand up. At the corner of my eye, it looks like somebody's raising their hand. Okay, now the other thing I want to do is I want to make this fur kind of hang down a little bit. Make sure you are attaching the right one.
So what did you change? What did you say you changed the before the inclination?
The specular color and the spec sharpness.
Okay.
Now the other thing, this is where I want to use my clumping. I'm going to crank this up a little bit. Let's see what that looks like. It also looks like my tip width is way too wide because I can see the ends of the hair. I don't really want to do that, so I'm going to go to my tip width and crank that down to almost nothing. Yeah, now we're getting somewhere. Now the other thing I want to do is I want to adjust my clump shape. So right now it's set to 0, so it's just clumping at the base. This will show up in the feedback here. So if I change this clump shape, you'll see the hairs change, right? So I can go like that, which will give me like little spikes where I can let it clump just at the end. Usually what I do is I try to get it close like that, and then I'll add some noise to the clump shape down here. The trick is you get it like 80% of the way with the attributes up the top, and then you add your noise down the bottom. You can see that like it screwed up some of this stuff in here. So I probably went a little too crazy with that value. Sorry, buddy. We should have done fluid simulation. So I kind of have this chrome look to it. I think I'm going to drop this color back down to something closer to what I have. Or less clumps with the clumping frequency also. So if it looks like you've got way too many clumps or too few, you can crank that up.
at somebody.
Pine cone in the face. It's an upside down pine cone.
Upside down pine cone. Wet one's the tricky one, actually. So that's kind of it. I mean, you can maybe paint the color a little more. There's the dry one and the wet one, or the wet one and the normal one. So I want to do the dry one. Does anybody have any questions so far?
No.
Okay.
I'm still lost.
You're still lost?
It's
not a question.
That is not a question. That's a declarative statement.
Luckily for you, this is not English. What are you lost on?
Everything.
I don't know where I am.
No, just not now.
You what? Like she's literally lost.
Mine's won't ring though, so I don't know what's up with this.
I think you broke something. Alright, so there's the dry one, or the normal one, and the wet one. Now we want to do the dry one, like to frizz that one. So, in much the same way we did with the wet one, actually exactly the same way, we're going to go to our fur description more, duplicate. I don't want to duplicate the wet. I want to use the base as my starting point. That's why I call it the base. So I'm going to duplicate the base again. So I'm going to go to fur, edit fur description, base one. Right? I'm going to change this one to fur dry. And then I'm going to select this sphere. And I'm going to attach fur description, animal fur dry. Right? So now I'm going to frizz this one out quite a bit. So I'm going to lighten my colors now this time. I'm going to desaturate them a little bit too. I'm going to crank up the scraggle. Down the scraggle rock. Alright. And then... That might be enough, actually, to make them dry. Let's see. Too is when you're rendering these, if you set up shadows on your lights and stuff, keep in mind that it's got to figure out the shadow for each blade of hair. So that can increase your render time quite a bit. But it will also make it look awesome. So there's a trade-off time for awesome. So what you could do is set it up and then play Street Fighter or something like that.
What?
Is that a sneeze?
So what did you change? You just changed the
I changed the color and I added some frazzle to it. Some scraggle.
How much of the scraggle did you add?
Not too much. But just important. You can mess around with it, the slider and kind of get
it.
Alright, Alright, so let's look at all three of these together. Anybody have any questions, though, for the whole group yet?
Well, not the whole group.
Does anybody have any questions for the whole group?
Can I have a dollar?
That's not for the whole group.
The if you master this technique, you can have lots of dollars when you get hired somewhere. Because a lot of people don't do this because it's time-consuming and they don't like to fiddle with all the attributes. But it's not the toughest thing in the world, as you can see. And if you take your time with it, you can get really nice results pretty quickly. So it's not quite as easy as like texturing is. I mean, texturing is an art all by itself. But fur, you've also got the added complexity of, you know, how does it move? So we're just doing this for a still. But imagine if you were doing this for a movie, you know, all the problems you would have potentially. So like when we did Ice Age, we had a fur check pass. I mean, we didn't do fur exactly the same way as they do now, but when we work on the characters, we just have the geometry. We don't have hair on them, so we didn't know where the hair was. So you do a scene where, you know, the mammoth touches the baby like this with his trunk, and he brushes the baby's face and looks all nice, and then you get it rendered, and the fur is cutting into the eyeball of the baby. Like, you can't do that. So we had to do fur check passes where they just take one or two frames and render just those, and then we'd use that as a guide, and then we'd pull the trunk out a little bit farther so that we had room for it to clear, or we'd hide that. You know, we'd move the camera a little bit, hide that angle or something. If we couldn't get around it, we'd shoot around it. But, yeah.
I have no clue what it's
doing. So for next week, what you need to do is one image of a dry sphere, a normal sphere, and a wet sphere that's furry, right? If we can't tell which one's dry, which one's wet and which one's normal, then get back to it. Right? So you guys saw what we did, how we did it. It's also on tape. So you can play it back.
I guess, right? I can stop it now.
Your mom.
Cool. Now I can start cursing.